Welcome to today's lecture. Today we start with chapter 4 in our lecture notes on Schmüttgen's Positivstellensatz, and the section we will treat today is 4.1 on the abstract Archimedean Positivstellensatz. So if you remember the abstract real Stellensatz, maybe let's look at it again. When there was this special case of it, namely the abstract Positivstellensatz, which is very important. So if AT is a preordered ring and A in A, then we had, if you view A as kind of a function on the real spectrum, when it's strictly positive pointwise on the real spectrum of this preordered ring AT, if and only if there is an algebraic certificate for this, namely, for example, of this form. And here you have this T here, this multiplier T, and you know, you could view this somehow as a denominator, because in situations where you can invert the T, you can move it to the other side here. And so this dominator, however, creates problems for some practical applications, like in polynomial optimization. We won't go into that now. So, and you also know that you have already seen other situations where you have theorems where you don't need denominators, where you have, for example, if you have a real polynomial in one variable which is non-negative on the real line, when it's just a sum of squares of polynomials. You don't need rational functions, you don't need denominators. Okay, so the question, but in general, so we had already seen the Motzkin polynomial, which was a non-negative polynomial, real polynomial in two variables, which was globally non-negative, but was not a sum of squares of polynomials, even though it was, by Artin's solution to Hilbert's 17th problem, a sum of squares of rational functions. So in general, you see that these denominators might play a big role. But the question is, when can you avoid them? And then there was a big surprise only in the 1990s, in 1991, Konrad Schmüttgen, a functional analyst from Leipzig, proved his by now famous Positivstellensatz, where he said, that in some situations, we'll come to this later, you can, in some very general situations, you can even avoid the denominators, even in the case of several variables, even in a multivariate case. Right, so, but first, you know, before we prove a Positivstellensatz, we prove an abstract Positivstellensatz again. And so this abstract Positivstellensatz is now one without denominators. And it's, for some reason, it will be called the Archimedean Positivstellensatz, because that refers to a hypothesis that is needed. Okay. And this abstract Archimedean Positivstellensatz itself was known much longer, was known already before Schmüttgen's famous Positivstellensatz. And it will work for so-called Archimedean preordered rings. What is an Archimedean preordered ring? Well, you remember that a preordered ring is a commutative ring A together with a preorder of A. That's a preordered ring. And, well, this is called Archimedean. Well, in a special case, we had it already. Namely, if A is a field and T is not only a preorder, but even a prime cone of this field, or in other words, an order of this field, then we had already defined what is an Archimedean ordered field, and you should all know this by now. And the definition was exactly the same as here. If for all a in a, there exists an n in n such that m plus a lies in t. The difference is just now that this is a commutative ring instead of a field, and this is a preorder instead of an order, right? And so maybe let's compare with 1120d, where we formulated this. So this was, I mean, it was a reformulation of a definition because ordered fields were, at the beginning of a lecture, were have been defined with the order being a binary relation. Later we saw that we could see it as a subset. And if we see it as a subset, then this was the definition. So you see it's exactly the same thing. And at that time this was equivalent to this condition that every element of K can be written as the difference of an element from P and a positive integer. The rational numbers are always contained in an ordered field because it's a field of characteristic zero. And therefore the integers are contained. And but you could also say equivalently every element is a sum of an element of P with an integer, or you could say a sum of an element of P with a rational number. Now here I gave the same two equivalent reformulations, T minus N equals A and T plus Z equals A. I did not put the third one because the third one does in general not make sense because the rational numbers might not be contained as a sub ring in A. But the integers have to be interpreted here in the following way, that every ring has by definition a one multiplicative unit, and then this gives me a ring homomorphism, a unique ring homomorphism from the ring of integers into A, which sends one by one because a ring homomorphism has to do this by definition. You also know that you can prove that a ring homomorphism sends 0 to 0. If it sends 1 to 1, it has sent 2 to 2, right? Where 2 here means 1 plus 1. And so on, and minus 1 to minus 1, etc. So you know there is this unique ring homomorphism. And this is to be understood in this sense. So this positive integer is actually the image under this ring homomorphism, which might not always be injective, right? Even though the cases where this is not injective probably here are not very interesting. Anyway. Good. So let's just look at it again because it's so important. For all a in A, there exists a positive integer such that m plus a lies in t. That means t is already quite big somehow, right? And why is this equivalent? So yeah, that means that every element from A can be written as something from T minus some positive integer. It's exactly the same thing, only that you put the n here with minus n to the right-hand side in some sense, right? And then, of course, this, so this is certainly equivalent to this, and of course this implies this. And conversely, if I have an element which can be written as an element from T plus an integer. Now, if this integer is positive, if this integer is negative, I've already shown that I have also such a representation. But if this integer is non-negative, well, then I can deduce one from this integer, and add V1 here instead, right? Because V1 lies in T, because 1 is a square. Okay, and so I get smaller and smaller non-negative integers until I reach 0, and then with one more step I reach -1. So maybe it was a little bit too fast, but it's very easy to get from here to here. Okay. So let A be a commutative ring. A preordered T of A is called Archimedean if a preordered ring AT is Archimedean. That's not very astonishing, right? And A is called Archimedean if, on the other hand, a commutative ring A is called Archimedean if A together with the sums of squares, which is the smallest preorder of A, is Archimedean. So now we abstract Archimedean positive Stellensatz. So that was actually probably known even before Cribbin, maybe not exactly in this form, but more or less I think Stone and Caddison knew this already. And then Cribbin wrote it explicitly, and probably Dubois rediscovered it also. Stone was even in the 40s already. And I don't know if he knew really this version, but he could have known it probably. And when Caddison in the 50s and Cribbin in the 60s and Dubois also in the 60s, right? And let AT be an Archimedean preordered ring and A in A, when the following are equivalent. A hat is positive on the real spectrum of AT, and there exists an N in N such that N times A lies in 1 plus T. Okay, so let's maybe compare this to the abstract positive Stellensatz from 3.4.4, just to compare it. We copy it here. Okay. So what's the difference? So here we have the same condition. Here we have an additional hypothesis, namely that preorder T is Archimedean. And here we have a similar condition, only that here we have a positive integer as, let's say, denominator or as multiplicator. And here we have an element from T as multiplicator. Now, I said I want something denominator-free. Well, in many cases, you can then put, you know, in many cases, you will able to invert n, right? And then, and if you can invert n, if capital N is invertible in your commutative ring, when 1 over n is actually a sum of squares, because 1 over n is, you know, is n over n squared, and this is 1 over n squared plus 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 etc. 1 over n squared. So it's a sum of squares and therefore lies in T. Right, and so if I put it on the other side, I get that A lies in T. Yeah? Or maybe I can get something a little stronger, that A lies in, you know, 1 over n P. plus t. So in this way, you could then put vn to the other side, and you have something like denominator 3. And that's a big advantage, right? Clearly, this condition here implies that one, because positive integers or its images in A under a unique homomorphism lie in T, right? So it's just a stronger condition, which is very important sometimes. The price we have to pay is that we have to assume here Archimedean. Now let's prove this. From B to A, this is trivial. We had already seen this because, you know, I said this implies the condition from abstract positive Stellensatz, which in turn also implies this, right? I think you can do it. So it was already trivial in the abstract positive Stellensatz. From A to B, there is a little technicality here, which is usually not a problem, but sometimes it might be, so I have to say things about it. So here I would actually prefer that the positive integers are invertible. All positive integers are invertible. In many cases this will be the case, but I don't know if this is the case in this commutative ring A. So what I mean here by n times 1 is, you know, is the image under the canonical homomorphism, you know, because n times 1 is now my notation for 1 plus 1 plus 1, n times. Okay, and... in order to reduce to this case, I employ a little trick. So I look at the multiplicative set S of all positive integers in A or of its images. And then the localization with respect to S is again a commutative ring. And we know that in this commutative ring, we have this pre-order S to the minus 2t. That was, of course, just the set of all A over T, where A lies in T. A over S squared, where A lies in T and S in S. So this is an Archimedean pre-ordered ring. Why is it Archimedean? Because, if I have an element of its localization, right? So if I have A in A and S in S, and then A over S, that's a general element of its localization, then I have to show that I can add a natural number, or I can add a positive integer, so that this will be in this pre-order. But S here is also a positive integer, or the image of a positive integer, right? So I can just take I can first write this as A times S divided by S squared. And then I can add here I can choose a positive integer n such that n plus A times S lies in T, because T is Archimedean. And then it's for sure... also true that S squared times n plus a s lies in T, right? Because I could add several times n to this thing. And so, and when I get here with n plus n s squared plus a s divided by s squared lies in s to the minus 2t, but this is n plus a over s. So for a in a and s in s, I have found a positive integer n. I've chosen it namely in this way, such that n plus a over s lies in this localized preorder. So therefore it's again an Archimedean preordered ring. And we have to check that a hat is positive on the real spectrum of this preordered ring if a over 1 hat is positive on the real spectrum of this ordered ring. So let's check this. So if I have a p in the real spectrum of at, and I suppose that, let's say I suppose already that the green thing here is true, that I know this. So now when does this element in the real spectrum correspond to an element here? Well, if the support of P does not intersect S, right? And this will actually always be the case, right? Well, support of P will not intersect S. Since, for example, 1 cannot be in the support of P because the support of P is a prime ideal. But 2 can also not be in the support of P because if it were, then minus 2 would be in P. And then minus 1 would be in P. You know, and with the same reasoning, you can then show that minus, that 3 cannot be in the support of P and so on, 4. And so this intersection is empty. So by 3, 3, 4, we know then that s to the minus 2p is in the real spectrum of localization. And actually it's trivial because t is contained in p. It's trivial that it's in the real spectrum of this preordered ring here, right? And now because we had the green hypothesis here, we know that a hat divided by 1, a over 1 hat is positive at s to the minus 2p, right? Well, what does that mean? That means that a over 1 lies not in minus s to the minus 2p. But from this it follows, of course, that a lies not in minus p. And that means a hat evaluated at p is positive, right? And since p was an arbitrary element in the real spectrum of at, I have this. And conversely, now let us now start from the other condition here. Let's say we assume here that a hat is positive on spare at. And now I want to prove this. Okay, so let Q be in the real spectrum of this localization with this localized preorder. Then we know by 3, 3, 4, Q is of a form s to the minus 2p, for some P in the real spectrum of A with such that the support of P does not intersect S. And now by the green hypothesis here, I know that we have A lies not in minus P. And we have to show that A over 1 lies not in minus Q. Okay, so now I do so maybe we show this by contraposition. So we start by saying here, suppose A over 1 lies in minus Q, and then we have to show A lies in minus P. Okay, so and of course here A in A, right? Okay, so if A over 1 lies in minus Q, then choose S in S such that A over 1 equals, choose A in S and B in Q. In B and P such that A over 1 equals minus B over S squared, right? Because Q is S to the minus 2P. Now I clear the clearing denominators. We get T in S such that T S squared A equals minus T B, which lies, of course, since T is a non-negative integer, lies in P. In minus P. And now I get, by the property of a prime cone, I get that since P is a prime cone, we have Ts squared lies in, maybe I should put, to be more clear, maybe put the minus on this side, so when minus T is squared A. T is squared times minus A lies in P, and therefore T is squared lies in P, and therefore minus T is squared lies in P, or minus minus A, which is of course equal to A, lies in minus P. Yes. And this is impossible because minus a positive integer cannot lie in P because otherwise minus 1 would lie in P. Okay. So it must be true that what I color here in green must be true. So and this is just a... Okay, so it was a little exercise actually. So now I have here that, you know, that this A is equivalent, let me write maybe A prime. So in the case where, yeah, let me write A prime that A over 1 hat is positive on the real spectrum of this thing. Let me write here another condition B prime, saying that there exists N in N such that A N A over 1 lies in 1 plus S2 minus 2T. And I claim, so we have just seen that A and A prime are equivalent. But I claim that also B and B prime are equivalent. Why are B and B prime equivalent? Well, one condition is completely trivial from left to right, and for the other one it should be easy. So if n in n such that n a over 1 equals 1 plus a over s squared with a in t and s in s. When I clear dominators, when I get t in s such that t s squared n a equals t s squared plus t a, and you know, and the right hand side lies actually, and when we are done, because you know, I could take this for my new n, for n I need here. And you know, this here can be written as 1 plus some other non-negative integer, right? And then this other non-negative integer plus TA, that lies certainly in T, right? So in this way I get from B prime to B. Right. So we are now proving A implies B, right? And the way I will prove A implies B is that I go from A to A prime, and then from A prime to B prime, and then from B prime to B, right? So I've actually shown here equivalences, but we need always just one direction, right? It was actually the harder direction, I think, that we needed each time. But none of the directions is really hard. So we can therefore suppose now that negative integers are invertible in A. And therefore we have a homomorphism from a unique homomorphism, actually from rational numbers, right? Which are nothing else than the localization of Well, usually you are inclined to say that rational numbers, that's, you know, the localization with respect to this multiplicative set of ring of integers. But it's also true that it's the localization with respect to this multiplicative set, of course, right? Okay, so, and yeah, and then you easily get this homomorphism. People from algebra know why, because exactly because of this condition, you get a unique ring homomorphism which extends the canonical homomorphism from the ring of integers to A, and that's exactly this one. And now suppose that A holds. So some sense now we have rationals in there, right? And that helps us a little bit. So suppose now that A holds, when we use the abstract positive Stellensatz 3.4.4. Now I said the abstract positive Stellensatz was only proven by Krivine in the 1960s. And but I said that Stone probably already knew this theorem. So that's because there are other ways of proving it, right? Which are more elementary. But I use the abstract positive Stellensatz. Actually, in this case, the abstract positive Stellensatz, the proof would simplify a lot if you think about it for a few days. So, anyway, by the abstract positive Stellensatz 3.4.4, there is some t in t such that ta lies in 1 plus t. Now, since t is Archimedean, now come a few tricks. This is, you know, we want to replace this t somehow by a positive integer, right? And okay, this one we might also have to replace by a positive rational or something. So, since, and in order to do this replacement, so that's not easy, that's really tricky, really, really tricky. But one of the steps is that you choose this n, because t is Archimedean, we can choose a positive integer n such that n minus t lies in t. Okay. And the next trick is that we choose a rational, that we choose a positive integer r such that a plus r lies in t. Can also do that, right? So, you know, that's finally I want something like this. And so I do a few things which are a little bit similar. The first thing I do with the abstract positive Stellensatz, I get here a t instead of an n, which is worse, right? And then somehow I would like to exchange this t by a capital N, by a positive integer n. So I choose here with the Archimedianity, I choose here with capital N, maybe it helps something in the end. And then the third thing I do is also a bit, you know, is just that here I would be very happy if I had A equals 1, is can be written as something of a form 1 plus something in T. And here I, yeah, in this vein, I choose here an R in N such that A plus R lies in T. And now we had the ideas this R in particular is a rational number. It's really tricky. This R is a positive integer, but I could also say it's a rational number with whose denominator is this fixed capital N. And in the numerator, there is some non-negative integer. Right? I can certainly write it in this way. Right? So it's just a trick. And when I decrease it, I make it smaller and smaller, but always staying in this set, always being such a rational number with denominator capital N. I decrease it a finite number of times by 1 over n. Right? Assuming it's still non-negative, right? And I do it until this gets negative. Okay, certainly you can do this, and after finitely many steps you will be negative because the denominator was always this capital N. There cannot be too many steps, like capital N times R or capital N times R plus 1 or something steps. But in the end I get certainly to why can I decrease this? I mean, when I say I can decrease this, I mean the tricky thing is, of course, that I still want this condition, right? Otherwise, it would be trivial. I still want this condition, and that's very, very tricky. That's just a one-line identity, which is kind of genius. Namely, I want to replace a plus r minus 1 over n, but I still want this to be in t. Now, but this is, just look at that wonderful identity. That's n minus t, which was in t. Oh, maybe we color this. N minus t was in t. Times a plus a, which was in t. Times t a minus 1, which was in t. Times RT, which was also in T because R was a because R was still non-negative until the last step, right? So here it's still non-negative rational number, and non-negative rational number is in T, for the same reason as always. I think I showed it many times. For example, this non-negative rational number is thirteen times 7, and this is 1/13 squared plus 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 plus. So it's sum of squares. 7 times 13 times. Okay, good. So that's R lies in T, and therefore RT lies in T. So here I have a product of elements of T that lies in T. When I add something from T, that lies in T. And I add something from T. So it's still in T. And when I multiply with a non-negative rational number, it's still in T. Yeah, so it's in T. And that works if R is non-negative. And when I decrease R stepwise always by 1 over n at a time, and when in the last step when this gets negative, I cannot take this as my new R because here I needed that R is non-negative because of this here. But I can do it until this is negative, until, okay. And when it follows that a minus 1 over n lies in t. Because r is negative. In the last step, R will be decreased. At some point it will be 0, and then at the next step it will be minus 1 over n. So a minus 1 over n lies in t. That's really nice, right? And thus n a lies in 1 plus t. And we are done. So it's a typical proof of real algebra. You need to find some stupid identity which in the end is a one line identity or two lines, but which you have looked for maybe a few weeks. Okay, or even longer. So that's the main theorem for today, but we want to draw a corollary. So let A be a commutative ring and P a point in the real spectrum when the following are equivalent. P is Archimedean and A is a maximal prime cone. The quotient field of A mod P together with this induced order is Archimedean. It's an Archimedean ordered field where fracture P is the support of P. The real representation field of P is Archimedean. That's actually the real closure of that one. And there exists a homomorphism phi from A to R such that, you know, of P is the preimage under phi of the non-negative reals here. Okay. So I referred you to several things, so let's have a reminder on this thing. So 412A was just the definition of an Archimedean preorder. When 3111 was this definition of this that this prime cone induces an order of this quotient field of A modulo its support. And this 3115, that was the real representation field. That was just the real closure of this. Good. So I think the statement should be clear. Now let's go for the proof. From A to B. So suppose that A holds, so P is Archimedean and a maximal prime cone. And now let A in A and S be in A without P, and we have to find a non-negative positive integer such that this fraction here, a representative modulo of fracture P actually, so it's an error. That should be fracture P. Here that should be a fracture P. So I have to correct this in the lecture notes. So what I mean is that you take the residue class or congruence class modulo fracture P and you divide it by the congruence class of S modulo fracture P. Right. So we have to find this positive integer n such that this lies in this order PP. So without loss of generality, S lies in P because S lies in P or else S lies in minus P. I could exchange S by minus S if I at the same time exchange A by minus A. That's just another representation of this fraction. So without loss of generality, S lies in P. So since P is maximal, we have that on in the real spectrum of this preordered ring, there is only this one element. And therefore, S hat is positive on the real spectrum of this preordered ring. S lies not in the support of P. That's what I use here also, so that I get really positivity. Now, by the real representation theorem, there is an n prime in n, such that n prime times S lies in 1 plus P. Yes, and now I choose an n prime prime such that a plus n prime prime lies also in P. And I set n as a product of n prime and n prime prime when a plus ns equals a plus n prime and prime prime s. But n prime s lies in 1 plus P. So this lies in a plus n prime prime plus p. And this is contained in P plus P, you know, because A plus and prime prime lies in P. It's in P plus P, that's contained in P. And thus A plus NS times S lies in P times P, contained in P, because S was in P. And it follows that, you know, that now if I divide here, you know, the product of these two things lies in P, so by definition of this prime cone, this fraction here lies in PP, but that fraction is actually exactly this fraction plus N, which we wanted. So maybe this was a bit of an overkill to use the Archimedean positive Stellensatz here, but you can do it. I think in the exercises we had actually a similar exercise where you saw that you can do it directly without using the Archimedean positive Stellensatz, but it's more convenient to use that. From B to C, if B holds, then you know, when this Archimedean or every Archimedean ordered field embeds into as an ordered field into real numbers by 1, 1, 17, see also 1, 1, 5. Let's see. Yes, here, and see also 1, 1, 5. Yes, it's about what is an embedding of an ordered field. Okay, good. And the real representation field is the real closure. Okay, so we have here this ordered field. And here we have an ordered field extension, which is algebraic over this, namely this real representation field, and here we have an embedding of ordered fields, and you know we have learned that there is a unique extension embedding of ordered fields from here to here. We don't need the uniqueness, just the existence of this extension. By 1, 7, 5 we have this. Okay, and then up to isomorphy, this ordered field is a subfield of real numbers and therefore must be Archimedean also, of course. And the D, where exists a homomorphism from A to R. Ah, okay, so let's see. So from C to D, if RP is Archimedean, why does there exist a homomorphism phi from A to R such that pre-image of a non-negative real consists exactly of the elements of P? Now choose an embedding from, so if C is Archimedean, then choose such an embedding iota here. Maybe we should write suppose that C holds, in order to make clear what is the logic. So when choose such an embedding iota from RP to R, since RP is an Archimedean ordered field, right? All Archimedean ordered fields embed into the real numbers. So now we have that the pre-image of a non-negative reals is this, because iota is an embedding of ordered fields. Now we said, you know, we have this real representation which maps A to RP, and we take a composition with iota. And that's a homomorphism, right? So we have from A to RP, we have this row P. And then here we have a iota to real numbers. And the pre-image of and the composition is phi, right? Then the preimage of a composition of a non-negative real numbers is the preimage of a non-negative real numbers. But that was the non-negative elements here. So I get the preimage of non-negative elements of RP under the representation, and that's by 3.1.16, this is P. Let's look at 3.1.16. I mean, you can also check it again if you want, but in 3.1.16 it was written here. Okay, so we have D. And from D to A, if there exists such a homomorphism to the reals, whose preimage of a non-negative reals is P, then suppose we have such a thing. So now we have to show P is Archimedean and a maximal prime cone. So P is Archimedean for if A in A, when one can choose n in n with phi of a plus n greater than or equal 0, and Fuller's that a plus n is the, in the preimage of a non-negative reals, which was P. In order to show that P is maximal, let Q be in the real spectrum with P contained in Q, we have to show that P equals Q. If we had an A in Q without P, we want to get a contradiction out of this. When phi of A is smaller than 0, right, because P was with preimage, and when phi of n times A is less than or equal minus 1, right, because that's just a negative real number, I can find a big integer n, such that if I multiply it with n, I'm less than or equal minus 1, right? From which it would follow that phi of minus nA is greater than or equal 1, and when phi of minus 1 minus nA is greater than or equal 0. And thus minus 1 minus nA lies in P, which is contained in Q, right? And minus 1 minus nA plus nA, you know, nA lies in Q because A lies in Q, right? And so we have this lies in Q plus Q, and this is contained in Q, and that's a contradiction. Minus 1 cannot be an element of a prime cone. Okay, that's it for today. Many thanks for listening, and I hope we see us next time. Thank you.